We're near the town of Mojácar, which is this beautiful white box building town. You know, real picturesque, just a classic TripAdvisor 12 things to do in Andalucía cover image kind of place. And you know, I've been saying Andalucía because that's how the locals say it. But I'll be honest, every time I'm about to put the TH sound in there, I get a little self-conscious, as if some Spaniard is gonna whip his head around and be like, what? Hey everybody, this asshole's trying to sound like us. Come on, get him. Just don't wanna offend any of the locals. Don't wanna get punched in the face. I'm just really hoping the cloud cover burns off, and if it doesn't, I gotta figure out some way to make those beautiful white buildings look beautiful even in ugly light. We were on our way to Mojácar, and our driver, Orencio, pointed out the window and said, look, 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 look. And we knew right away we had to stop. Two pools. This place was classy. We love music. Whether it's the deserts of California or the most beautiful region of Spain, I managed to end up at the most abandoned, ugly places. Like a fly on shit. Right.
This little nightclub resort thing wouldn't be the last abandoned building I shot on day 5. In fact, it wasn't even second to last. And I'm gonna level with you, dear viewer. I think I took too many pictures of urban decay by the time the sun went down. Even by my standards. But, you know, I was in the groove at this moment, feeling real motivated to take these pictures, so I just went with it. I'd taken so many classically pretty landscapes over the past 2 days, maybe I just needed to get some ugly in my life. After my 6x17s, I switched over to Ilford HP5 Plus on 4x5.
The yellow filter, 36 at 1/15. There we go.
Decent stuff, no showstoppers, but was mostly just enjoying the peace and quiet of using my view camera amongst the rubble of other people's good time memories.
Oh, and you can see Mojácar up there.
Yeah, and El Cielo here on the floor, you see? The yeah. Heaven.
Is that what that means? The heaven? So that was the name of this place.
Yeah.
Before we finally moved on to our actual destination for the day, I switched over to the Fuji to get some unremarkable snapshots that really didn't need to be brought into this world.
That's the good stuff.
But hey, sometimes I take pictures just for the enjoyment of it, even when the photos themselves are nothing special. And don't you dare suggest I'm just saying that as a defense mechanism against criticism.
Possibly, Walt Disney was born in Mojácar. Minnie Mouse? She's got the documents. Globalist scum. That same file has the truth on who killed JFK.
I love a good low stakes conspiracy theory. Like, even if Disney was born in Mojácar, doesn't mean we need to start stockpiling food and ammo. It's just some good time funsies to speculate on. But they're serious about it in this town. There wasn't just one mural. And we found a house with a placard suggesting it was once home to baby Walt.
Really not gonna let this Walt Disney thing go, are they?
You should Google the backstory, by the way. It's actually pretty interesting. But back to the photography.
Spanish cats, man. They don't like me. They don't trust a foreigner.
I will pet a cat before I go home. Come here.
Come on, kitty.
Come on. I think you'd be all right with the photo.
Kitty.
Now you look at me. There we go. Hi. Hi. Well, aren't you cute? I'm doing it. I'm petting a Spanish cat. Oh, you're so soft. Kitty.
Gato, gato, gato.
Mojácar is absolutely gorgeous. The perfect town for a romantic getaway with your sweetheart. Not quite as romantic with a burly videographer from Oklahoma and a Spaniard who was just getting paid to make sure I didn't get lost or clipped by a bus. Neither of them would let me slip my arm under theirs and nestle my head against their shoulder while I asked, would you still love me if I was a worm? A beautiful place indeed. And that was the problem. It was picturesque, and so, of course I didn't want to take pictures. There's something wrong with my brain, you see, that makes me not want to take pictures of pretty things like this. Especially things that everyone would take a picture of. I just wasn't into it. And what happens when I'm not into it? Mediocrity. Funny enough, I could actually see the ruins of El Cielo from way up here, just teasing me.
Kind of wish I was back down at that shitty building.
Sometimes I feel like I could be the subject of a psychology student's entire PhD thesis. Lots to unpack in my brain. But eventually, I found something classically beautiful that I actually did really want to photograph.
I'm using my longest focal length lens here, my 300. And this lens has a massive image circle, which is good, because I'm gonna need it here. I'm gonna do a massive amount of rise. But I don't have enough rise on my camera, so I'm gonna have to tilt my camera back and then bring the standards back to vertical. I'm close to it anyway. Get a level on it. Yeah, that's giving me enough rise. I just need to make sure I'm not exceeding the image circle on this lens. You can tell that by looking down the lens, and if you can see the corners of the ground glass, you're in the clear, and I am well in the clear. Focus on this will be easy because pretty much everything is at infinity, but I'm still gonna use a pretty narrow aperture because my frame is so far to the edge of the image circle, I want to close the aperture to get as even illumination and as even of sharpness all the way to the edge.
There we go. A pretty photo of a pretty thing. You'll notice here that my subject looks compressed. In other words, the buildings from near to far kind of flatten out onto each other, making it look like they're all on roughly the same plane. It's a common misconception in photography that this kind of compression is created by long focal length lenses. The lens has nothing to do with it. It's your distance to your subject that creates the compression. The further you back up, the more compressed things get. I wanted compression here to enhance the sense of density and people living on top of each other. That's a big part of the charm of this place. Lucky for me, we found this perfect little parking lot that allowed me that distance from which to shoot.
This place is begging for a pano, but panoramics of Mojácar are a dime a dozen. And nobody does 4x5. All right, I'm doing a pano. That'll be the most unique pano in this region that the world has ever seen.
I didn't show it on the video, but I actually waited around for some time before I snapped this exposure. I was keeping a close eye on the drifting clouds and hoping one would slide in front of the sun to diffuse the light a little bit, but not too much. You can see the shadows are less dense and more feathered than on the previous composition, which gives me a photo that's a little softer, but not completely devoid of depth. The film here is Portra 160, same as the 4x5 shot. Portra's sweet tones, that's with a Z, combined with the nearly monochromatic paint scheme of the buildings and the slightly softened light, all work together to give me a nice, dreamy, simple color palette. Place kind of looks like heaven, doesn't it? Or should I say, El Cielo? Well, look at that. We tied it all together. Before we made our way back down the hill, I found one more composition for 6x17. Something else worth Googling while you're checking out the Disney conspiracy is the Kowloon Walled City of Hong Kong. It was demolished in 1994, but it had a very specific aesthetic that has been referenced in all sorts of movies and video games. There's one photo of it in particular on Wikipedia that shows a bunch of antennas sticking out the top of the buildings and people's laundry hanging out to dry on their balconies and roofs. I'm sure you know where I'm going with this. This scene, with its antennas, cables, and clotheslines, looked to me like a Spanish version of Kowloon, minus the brothels and opium dens. I love finding scenes with this kind of timeline dichotomy. You know, the antennas tell me it's the future, but the unmentionables hang drying on a clothesline beg to differ. Like, when is this exactly? So I ended my time in Mojácar on a high note with these three shots. But the day wasn't over, and I wanted to get more photos somewhere else. Ah, geez, more Urban Decay. All right, I wasn't even going to share this stop with you. I was just trying to recharge my batteries before dusk without a video camera in my face. Because at this point, even I was thinking, all right, we get it with the abandoned buildings, Nick. Modern ruins, the passage of time, deep commentary on mankind's impermanence. Great. But then I actually liked some of the shots. I think I may have finally gotten the whole abandoned places on film thing out of my system on this trip. It's starting to feel a little cliche. Ha! Starting. It's been cliche, honey, for a while, and that hasn't stopped me yet. So yeah, this probably won't be the last of it from me.
Spotted this building on the way to our hotel last night. Got a single light over it, which is gonna look really cool at dusk. I haven't shot any buildings at dusk yet on this trip, so I'm fiending for it. The light's so damn beautiful right now. I think I need to get a couple shots of it. Damn nice view of this little valley down here. Man. Gorgeous light. Jeez. It looks so much like Southern California. Southern and Central California. Now we're done.
Dude. Yes. Once again, I've created something that won't be going in any tourism brochures, but still, I'm so effing happy with this one. There are a lot of things working in my favor here to give the photo tons of depth. For one, the fact we're perched at the edge of a valley gives me real good separation between foreground and distant background. Secondly, the overhead lights brighten the subjects against the dark hills and cast shadows that create dimension. And finally, the yellow color of the building pops in perfect color contrast with the deep blue-purple sky. You know how I love capturing dichotomies in my work? There's a great one here. The boarded up building, the broken gate, the cracked pillar, and the abandoned chair all say neglected property. But there's one thing that says this place still matters to someone. That snowflake. You don't put up a Christmas decoration like that unless you have some pride in your property. Or maybe it's put up by the city. I don't know. Don't care. Love it.
Big day today. Got the production crew out with me. They're sending a production crew to create a little bit of a documentary for this whole project, and they're spending a day with each photographer. And today is my day. So they're gonna be following me along. It's a big, serious production. And I gotta say, man, I'm freaking excited. Just driving in, the terrain is unbelievable. It reminds me so much of the deserts of Southern California, but like more rugged, a little more beautiful, more texture. And I don't know, it's awesome, man. I'm stoked for today. It's gonna be good.
This little intro is the only time I'd be talking to the camera on day 6 because I spent the rest of the day devoting all of my attention to the production crew making the documentary. When you're gonna have a crew of 9 with a $75,000 cinema camera pointed at you all day, you don't wanna give them short shrift. That and our driver, my videographer, and I went a little too hard the night before. We all needed to dial back the throttle today. But I still have plenty of stuff to show you, including 2 of my favorite photos from the whole trip. We'll get there. Let me first get this out of the way. I think I fell in love with the production crew. I've never had the pleasure of working with such a professional group of like-minded creatives. From the director, to the camera op, to the sound guy, to the focus puller. Yes, they had an effing focus puller. Everyone from AVA, that's the production company, was a full-fledged badass. I could get used to working with people like this. I had specifically requested my portion of the documentary be shot here in the Tabernas Desert. I knew that's where I'd feel most comfortable and would likely create my best work. You may recognize this building but can't quite place it. This, folks, is the Black Museum from that one episode of Black Mirror. It was painted a different color and the signage is different, but it's the Black Museum, all right. I shot this on Portra 160 with my Rodenstock 115mm, and I stood a little further back than I might normally would have. Going back to that idea of compression, this further shooting distance caused the background hills to appear larger and closer, creating a sense of this structure being nestled in a massive desert, rather than just a big building at the edge of a puny landscape. By the way, if you want good light basically all day out in the desert, go in December. I shot this photo on December 9th at about 1:30 in the afternoon, but it looks like beautiful late afternoon light because the sun never gets that high up in the sky during the thick of winter. Oh, and you won't die of heat exhaustion. After the Black Museum and a quick lunch in the town of Tabernas, we ventured deeper into the desert to film another sequence of me taking pictures. I have no video of it, but here are some of the photos I took. The first one is actually from back near the Black Museum, but the rest of them are from this little valley we stopped in that had beautiful light and textures. This was all Kodak Portra 400 shot handheld with the Fuji GW692. Before we ran out of light, I wanted to get one more 6x17, but this valley wasn't the place to do it, So we hopped in the cars and started hunting, somewhat frantically, until I found this incredible overlook that would do just fine for my final shot of the day. Now, just like when I create these YouTube videos, the director of the documentary needed to keep the storyline moving smoothly from one shot to the next. So we filmed scenes of me, quote unquote, finding the spot and putting on my jacket while staring out into the desert with my best Clint Eastwood impression. But it's a good thing you can't see my face because my impression sucks. I just don't have the jawline or cheekbones or the piercing eyes. I don't know why I'm dancing around it. Clint Eastwood was hot in his prime. I mean, when he was the man with no name? Oh my. Where was I? Ah, yes. Speaking of movies that were filmed in the Tabernas Desert, portions of the 1962 classic Lawrence of Arabia were filmed right down there. Portra 160, the Nikkor 150mm, and some gorgeous sunset light. This is maybe my favorite photo from the whole project. But that might be a little biased because I'm largely just relieved that the photo isn't bad. So much of my portion of the documentary hinged on this shot because it was kind of like my finale, you know? And it just would have been humiliating if they put out this rad looking documentary where I'm trying so hard to look like a badass out in the desert and I'm pontificating about my slow contemplative shooting process, but then the final reveal of my work is some janky, poorly exposed snapshot. Like, can you imagine the comments? Oh, hotshot wannabe Clint Eastwood ain't such a good photographer after all. Typical YouTube photographer. So, I don't know, maybe it's not as strong as I think it is, but at least it's good enough that I won't have to quit YouTube.
Eighteen rolls of color, one roll of black and white. Oh, and 6 sheets of 4x5. That's what I've shot on this trip so far here in Spain. And this is what I have left. 7 rolls of Portra 160, 3 rolls of Portra 400, and way too much freaking Tri-X. I had a feeling I brought too much black and white film. I haven't really had much desire to shoot black and white. So I hope this is enough color film for today. I'm on the last day of the trip. We're going out to the Tabernas Desert again. And this desert has a long history in cinema. They filmed a lot of the spaghetti westerns out here. So like The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly was filmed out here and a whole bunch of others. And so there's a few theme parks out where we're going that are the old western studios, and they got, you know, fake western towns and all that. I don't have any interest in photographing those, but they have some pretty cool billboards, and I think I'd like to photograph those. I really like these billboards for all these theme parks out here, because they're kind of surreal to look at. They look almost like, I don't know, like a glitch in the simulation. Like simulation's trying to figure out, are we in Southern California? Are we in American Southwest? I don't know. So renders it on the fly, and what do you end up with? Texas Hollywood. Might add a little bit of mood to it, so no center ND this time. F22 at 125th. That one's gonna be sick.
Oh, yeah, it is Broski. Can you tell I'm from California? By the way, it goes without saying that the folks who made this sign are not confused about the difference between Texas and California. They know what they're doing. It's a way to market a theme park that celebrates Spain's role in making some of the most iconic Western films in the history of Hollywood. It's a clever name and a freaking cool sign. As I mentioned, I left off the center ND filter this time. This let the natural vignette of the lens come through, which I think gives it a touch more drama. I love the colors on this one. Again, that low winter sun on the desert landscape, serving up the goods. If you plan to visit this sign yourself, please be respectful because it is on the private property of the amusement park. We got the okay to do this, but we also made sure to not overstay our welcome and always leave no trace.
Shot way too many freaking pictures at that stupid gas station. So I'm running out of Portra 400. Texas Hollywood signs got me in a Texas Leica kind of mood. Now the question is, Portra 400 or Tri-X? The choice is yours. Actually, the choice is mine. F it, let's do Tri-X. We're not gonna tell anyone that picture was taken right on the side of the highway. I have to fight the urge to add more contrast. With a contrast filter, Tri-X is contrasty enough, I always push it too hard. Nope.
Feeling now like my many rolls of Tri-X weren't a total waste, we broke for lunch at a little roadside cafe with a Route 66 theme. I'd been planning to visit this place since I first started researching the area, and I assumed it would be a kitschy take on American culture that bordered on parody. But I was wrong. It was a genuine celebration of the American West, not a tongue-in-cheek caricature of it. The decor was rad. This table with the car bucket seats? Hell yeah. This Indian and coyote? Hell yeah. These? Hell freaking yeah. Between this place and the movie amusement parks, it was pleasantly surprising and actually kind of touching to see the reverence these folks have for American culture. It's not that I thought Spaniards would be unwelcoming, it's just that, well, I know the reputation Americans have in the rest of the world. Americans are dumb. Americans are fat. We're uncultured. That kind of stuff. And I swear, if I wasn't watching the Kardashians right now, I'd put down my Twinkie and tell you that makes my feelings not good.
I actually took a picture of this last night with the documentary production crew. But we were up on the hillside, I was further away. Wanted to come down here and see it a little closer up. It's freaking gorgeous, the white sand or dirt, whatever it is, the white ground. Looks so cool. Contrasting with the dark bushes and all that. All the erosion in the dirt here is stunning. Gives it so much texture. But I think I'll be breaking out some 4x5 in a minute. Can't remember which film holders have Ilford HP5 and which ones have Portra 160. So I'm checking the film code. Pretty sure it was holders 3 and 5 that had Ilford, but yes, okay. I knew I should have wrote it down. Been using my 90 millimeter a lot on this trip. This is the perfect situation for some lens tilt. Because I got a low foreground tall background.
And nothing tall in the middle.
All right. I think that's going to be a good one. That light colored ground against the dark plants and all the cracks and everything, I think that's going to look choice on black and white film. So I'll see if maybe I can find one more shot before the sun's gone completely.
I wouldn't say this is bad, but it's definitely not my best work. Mainly because it's kind of just a standard formulaic landscape. Wide angle, big foreground, leading line pulling you in. Tricks that work, but not super original. I took a second 4x5 shot, framed tighter on the erosion. Obviously the same idea as the similar color shot I took earlier. Also not my best work here, but I think the two of these images together make a decent diptych.
Trying to squeeze out one last panoramic before we lose the light. This will probably be the last photo of the trip, so I gotta make it count. Have to set up kind of quick, so the light is fading really fast. Yeah, this is the spot. Beautiful, beautiful dusk light.
Well, folks, that's a wrap on Spain. I may have only spent 7 days there, but that was long enough for Andalucía to carve out a little corner of my heart. This is a place of delicious cuisine, breathtaking scenery, and endless photographic opportunity. A place I could see myself spending a lot more time in. Yeah, I'm definitely going back. If you enjoyed this three-part series and you want to buy me a beer to say thanks, click the link in the description. I also got some prints from the trip available on my website. But thanks for coming along with me on this little journey. I do hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you next time.